It's certainly good to be at home again. I don't care what anybody says about Memphis. Memphis is home. And it is a place that is of such tremendous potential to the glory of God. And I believe that that is why it is so difficult to really, really have an easy go at it. You know, if it was easy to be a multimillionaire, a whole lot of folks would have accomplished it, wouldn't they? But it is the difficult and challenging things that gives an added sense of purpose and an added sense of accomplishment when the achievement is made. And there's one thing that the elder forgot in his introduction. If I had a hand in my introduction, I would have highlighted the fact that I am a graduate of Northside High School, the class of 1976. We will be celebrating our 40th anniversary or reunion in a few weeks. I would have asked him to emphasize that I'm a product of Klondike community and Smoky City in North Memphis. And the reason, wherever I go and wherever I have an opportunity to speak, that is always in the Bible that I give to them. Because I am thankful and proud of where God has allowed me to come from. And when anybody ever talk about Memphis, I am quick to remind them what they said about Jesus. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? I'm proud to, matter of fact, when I come home, I always make my kids go on a family history heritage tour, and I always take one myself. And on yesterday, I was in the area, so I drove down Walker Avenue to Mississippi Boulevard, made a left turn, came down to Jennings Street, and reminded myself of the Mississippi Boulevard days. Let me say that again. To remind myself of the Mississippi Boulevard days. See, the reason why what Dr. Cooper was saying was really a challenge for a lot of y'all sitting in here, because y'all didn't know what I just said. If you knew what I just said, That is to say, where you came from and where God has brought you and sustained you and kept you. And he gets no glory. He gets no glory out of you sweating in the Memphis heat. Glory to God. And all he wants to see is what you're going to do. And then he's going to make you God, what we just heard the choir sing. God is faithful. And he's able. And it's as good to be home. Where Claude Jones didn't have an opportunity to introduce me, but he did have some influence on the introducing. And we're going to do what we've come to do. I thank you, Pastor, for this opportunity, for entrusting me in his pulpit, in his absence. And he shared with me that you all have been talking about and emphasizing various things of developing a close relationship with Christ, and especially in the area of prayer. And so we want to be respectful and to honor the man of this house by continuing in that conversation around the issue of prayer. And to this end, I would invite you to turn with me to Matthew, the 6th chapter. And I'd like to invite you to read with me verses 5-8. Matthew, the 6th chapter. It's actually in the New Testament, and it is the first book that you come to. If you have it, I would invite you to stand with me, and I would invite you to read with me verses 5-8. And when thou prayest, thou for they love to pray and in the corners that they may be seen of men. Verily I say, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father, which is in secret. And thy Father, which seeth in secret, shall reward thee openly. But when ye pray, use not vain repetition as the heathens do, for they that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be ye therefore like me, for your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. May the Lord have a rich blessing to the reading, the hearing, the doing of his word. I gave Claude a formula to answer his question. And I told him I'd be up 10 times the amount of time that they take to introduce me. Short introduction, short sermon. Long introduction, well. This morning, I don't plan to be up before you too long. I want to just center my thoughts on the practice of prayer. The practice of prayer. Shall we pray? Father God, speak now to your waiting people. Bless thy people in spite of the instrument chosen, and let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. The passage that we just read is a part of a larger presentation of Jesus beginning in Matthew, the fifth chapter, and it continues through to Matthew chapter 7. It is commonly called the Sermon on the Mount. It is this particular portion within Matthew, the sixth chapter. Jesus moves from in the first chapter about the disposition and the attitude about those who are part of the kingdom of God, while those who reside in the earth, while they are waiting for the kingdom to come. He moves from the notion of what is the attitude and the disposition and the practices of those that are part of that kingdom to when he comes to Matthew chapter 6, he begins to discuss the spiritual disciplines of those who are a part of God's kingdom while here on the earth. And he highlights in the verses 1 to 16 three disciplines. The first one being that of almsgiving. That is to say, of our charity and our giving to those who are less fortunate, as well as giving to the cause of God. Then he turns to the prayer life of those who are part of the kingdom of God, and then he discusses fasting as a part of the spiritual discipline of those who are part of God's kingdom. It is this middle part that he discusses prayer. And he discusses prayer from verses 5 through 15. And this discussion of prayer is divided into two parts. The first part is what we will be dealing with, is the practice of prayer. And then the second part, verses 9 to 13, which we will not be dealing with, deals with the example of prayer. And then he ends his exposition on prayer with verses 14 and 15, where he highlights and places an emphasis on a critical component of prayer, which is worth talking about all by itself, and that is forgiveness as a crucial element of a Christian's prayer life. But what we want to focus on this morning for the time that we have is the practice of prayer. Jesus sets forth the practice of prayer by contrasting the way that hypocrites and heathens pray. And he contrasts the heathen and the hypocrite
with how you should pray. You see, the hypocrite has a distorted view of himself. The hypocrite compares himself with those who are worse than him, which allows him to think more highly of himself than he should really think. You see, the hypocrite prays to get notice of men. This is what Jesus had in mind in Luke 18, 10 to 18, when he takes the time to note two men's prayers. One leaves the way he came, and the other leaves justified. The heathen, on the other hand, has a distorted view of God. He recognizes his need and his unworthiness, but where the heathen is off track is his view of God, is that God needs to be appeased. That somehow God desires to have you to jump through extra unnecessary hoops to get God's attention. And so, unlike the hypocrite who prays to get men's attention, the heathen prays to get God's attention. And I would like to suggest to you that both distortions distorts our prayer and our prayer life. And both of them, and especially the heathen, causes us to be vulnerable to every religious charlatan and snake oil salesman that comes along that gives you a formula or a guarantee of how to get your prayers answered. Wouldn't it be nice if I could give you three steps today that would guarantee that every time you pray to God that you would get exactly what you want? But think about it just for a moment. That if you know more than God knows, then why are you praying to God? Do you really want a God that you can manipulate? That you know more about your situation and have a better clue as to how to deal with your situation than God? And it's precisely because of our distorted view of ourselves and our distorted view of God that creates a serious desperation within us that is oftentimes reflected in our prayer life. But I want you to note the admonition that Jesus begins with: when you pray. That is to suggest that you should pray. But if your prayer is going to have an impact on your life and reflect kingdom praying, then there are some basic principles that should guide your practice of prayer. Now, Jesus is not talking about public prayer or liturgical prayer. Jesus is not talking about intercessory prayer, which, by the way, intercessory prayer is about prayer in the context of building a relationship with God. And it's this that Jesus is setting forth to his disciples in his sermon on the mount.
All right.
Notice the setup. When you pray, don't pray like hypocrites, but pray like this. When you pray, don't pray like heathens, but pray like this. And it's in that that Jesus sets forth a very basic and clear terms that the practice of prayer should be private, should be direct, and should be simple. First of all, the practice of prayer should be private. Jesus says, but thou when thou prayest, enter into thy closet. Now, you know, the fascinating thing is that every now and then there are all of these different kinds of fads in prayer. And one of the most recent fad has been to pray out loud. And everybody come together and everybody pray out loud. And oftentimes we are instructed not to just mumble out prayers, but to pray loud. As if God is hard of hearing. And as if all of us praying out loud at the same time is going to impress God. Jesus says, when you pray, go into your closet.
All right.
And pray to your Father in secret.
All right.
Now, the question is, where is your closet? Now, back in the day, those that heard Jesus kind of understood what Jesus was saying. It is an anteroom, a little small room off from the main room where you're able to have some privacy. You see, when I was growing up, the first couple of houses that I lived in, matter of fact, the first three houses I lived in didn't have closets. We had chifferoles.
Yeah.
You know. But now, I know folks, they got closets that are as big as the room, my bedroom when I was growing up. It is, so we know about these, what a closet is. It is away from everything else, and it is a place of privacy. Now, is Jesus trying to say to his disciples that the only place that you can pray in a meaningful way is in a specific location? I don't think so. What Jesus was trying to communicate is this simple principle that when you pray, you ought to pray in private just to God. The only person that ought to hear what you're praying is God. Now, you don't have to have a location, but you can pray in your heart, wherever you are, and God will hear. should be direct. You see, Jesus says, pray to thy Father. You see, your prayers are directed to your Father. Now, this is a radical notion for Jesus' hearers, because in the day of Jesus, God was considered so transcendent and so removed that any attempt to claim relationship with God was considered blasphemous. But yet, he said to his disciples, when you pray, you are to pray to your Father.
That's right.
I believe, I'm afraid that I might offend someone, but you got a great pastor who's deep in the Word, and you can share your offense with him and he'll clean this up for you. But you know, there are some people today who their image of Father has them so broken and so messed up that it's easy for them to reject the notion of God altogether. And to those people, I believe that Jesus would say, when you pray, pray our Mother. Because this is about relationship. What Jesus is trying to communicate is in the most tenderest and caring human relationships that there is, that is the relationship that God wants us to have with God. You see, somebody who's wiser than I am said that prayer is opening up the heart to God as a friend. Not that it is necessary in order to make known to God what we are, but in order for us to receive. And that when our prayers are directed to someone that we believe that cares about us, that is concerned about us, like Jeremiah has declared, that I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. that when we approach God in private, we're able to direct our prayers to someone who we already know know, he says that for your Father knoweth the things that you have need of. Because God already knows what you have need of. God is just trying to get you in a position so that you know what your needs are, so that you will be in a position to receive what God already wants to do for you. You know, as Dr. Cooper was talking about what needs to happen, he used the term sacrifice a whole lot. You know, when it comes to money, sacrifice is for broke people.
Well, I got three.
I know Creflo Dollar's satellite is worshiping on Sunday.
Well,
but I'm getting nervous. I ain't going Creflo on y'all. But think about it for a moment. Think about it for a moment. If you had it, it wouldn't be a sacrifice.
Amen.
Is that right? Do you think God wants you to be broke? I stopped the folks. He's been doing shit, man. He studies this since I was a little boy. And you can check with him to see if I'm wrong about this. But you know the Bible says more about that other 90%?
Well,
than the Bible actually says about the 10%. We get all sweaty and upset about the 10%, and then don't say 10 plus 10. You really start getting nervous. But when God has more to say about the other 90%, and when you start living in the full counsel of the Lord, when you start living in the full counsel of the Word, starting with the tithe, because the tithe only says that I acknowledge that all that I have belong to you in the first place. That not only is there, Lord, not only is the fullness thereof, but I belong to Him. So that God has the right to tell me how to live my life, how to raise my children, how to spend my money. And why would God tell me how to raise my children, how to spend my money, how to eat? Except for the fact that God wants us to be in health and to prosper, even if our soul prospers. And the reason why most of us are broke is, first of all, we either don't trust God enough and we're holding on to what He has claimed is His. Now you gotta know that God doesn't need your 10%. You gotta know that. So that you gotta know that there's another reason why He's making the claim. And it's simply because in our messed up world and in our messed up mind, we sometimes get it confused and think it is because of our ingenuities, our creativity. You see, the thing is God already knows your condition. God already knows your situation. What God is waiting on is for you to recognize it and for you to recognize who has the solution to your situation and being willing to trust God with it.
That's right.
So he says that you don't have to spend all that time. Just get to the point. Lord, I'm broke and it's my fault. I need your help. I need your direction. I need your resources to help me be what you want me to be in the first place.
I remember I went to the Lord in a time of particular financial just messed upness. And you know what the Lord said to me? The Lord said, increase your giving. And then I got all biblical. I quoted the text, you gotta try the spirits. Make sure they are of the Lord. Lord, I'm telling you how messed up my finances are. I'm already returning a tithe, and I'm already turning a consistent amount that is a half a tithe. Every month you say you need to do more.
Well.
It had me so shooken. I'm from North Memphis. Did I tell y'all that before? Man, I was so messed up that when I was finally convinced that it was the Lord talking to me, I was so messed up that I couldn't tell my wife. Said, Lord, you know, my wife's gonna think I'm crazy. Can't do this. He said, no, you do it. And you know what? I increased our giving for 3 months before I ever said anything to my wife. And I said, you know what, Tara, the Lord has impressed me that we need to take our giving to another level. She said, but how can we do this? You know what the finances are. How can you do this? How can we do this? You can't. I don't see it. I said, you know what, baby? I've been doing it for the last 3 months. And you know, it's just like wearing this Fitbit. When you start doing what the Lord tells you to do, you start becoming more sensitive to doing it right.
Well.
See, this Fitbit ain't gonna do no walking for me. But every time I see it, I know I need to keep moving. Every time that I look at it, I'm reminded that I need to kind of look at what I'm eating. Now, it doesn't work as well with the eating because I eat with my right hand. This Fitbit is on the left. Everybody need to change sides. But God is saying, I already know your situation. I'm just waiting on you. So that if prayer then doesn't give me what I want when I want it, as the musicians come, then what's the point? This ain't gonna help my situation if you say just pray.
Well,
through various ways that I couldn't have thought of. Hallelujah.
see how you work this out. And in my 58 years, I can say today with assurance and conviction that the Lord has never, ever, ever, ever let me down.
He bathed my heart in love.
I don't know your story, but I know that if this is a human gathering, there has to be somebody here today that came looking for something to help to anchor them to make it through just one more week. And if that's you, I want to invite you to just join me at the altar. I'm not going to ask you to pray out loud about what your situation is. I'm just asking you to just come to the altar. Not even we're going to ask you to pray with the elders, just as a way of signifying that I'm going to stop trying to do it on my own, but I'm getting ready to give it to the Lord. That you bring it, whatever it is, you're going to bring it to the altar, and you're going to leave it here. If that's you, I want to invite you to come. There's somebody else here that the Spirit has drawn into his place. You've been struggling with a life decision. And that life decision is simply, am I going to trust God completely, 100% with my life? Which means being obedient to God and becoming a part of his church family here at Longview. Now, I don't know what it is that you're dealing with, what it is that you're struggling with that's preventing you from making that complete surrender, but I do know this, that there is absolutely nothing about you that God will ever, ever reject. So don't let a habit, don't let a worry about whether or not you're going to be able to hang in there and stick with it. The only question that you need to answer is this what God wants me to do today, right now? And if that's you, you're not a member of the Longview Heights S.D.A.
A lot better.
hold you any longer. But I gotta give you this opportunity. Oh God, we are so thankful for your love, for your mercy, for your grace. And that you would even give such a wretch as I an opportunity to participate in such an extraordinary experience of sharing your gospel and your good news. Lord, I feel and sense my inadequacies, my inabilities to carry the weight of such a privilege. So God, I ask that if any way that I have allow myself to get too much in the way to prevent one of your children from responding, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit will not penalize them, but will continue to strive until they say yes to you. Until they come to a place where they're able to give it all to you and not carry any away. So I pray, O God, that when we shall have left this place, that we have no remembrance of Russell Seay, but will have only lingering in our hearts and minds the experience of being with you today. In Jesus' name I pray.